Welcome, everybody. Please welcome Kushbu, the Bioinformagician. I'm really excited for our discussion today to discuss things on bioinformatics and a little bit about life and sharing her story. So a little bit of background, Kushbu, what got you into, actually, what is bioinformatics and what got you into bioinformatics?
Just a funny story, because every time I get asked that question, what is bioinformatics, I kind of get nervous, because I cannot say that in like simple layman terms without going to the technicalities, but I'll try my best today.
Okay.
So the way I see bioinformatics is that it's branching out from data science, and the domain that we're going to be focusing on is biology. And basically this field is an interdisciplinary field. This is like a very textbook definition, but a lot of fields, a lot of disciplines come together. So the idea behind bioinformatics is basically we apply computational techniques to process biological data. And there's a little bit of statistics, there's a little bit of math, there is, you know, a lot of other interdisciplinary fields, but these are the, I would say, the foundational pillars of bioinformatics. So we take a little from each of these fields, apply that knowledge to process the biological data, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. I mean, that's one of my favorite things about bioinformatics, like that it's so interdisciplinary. So there's so many different things to study, and then things are always changing, and it's like it's really interesting and really cool. Okay, I think you explained that beautifully. So then how did you get started in bioinformatics? Because I mean, you know, you ask most people, you know, they hear biology, they hear computer science, they might even hear about like biomedical engineering, but I feel like very few people still don't know much about bioinformatics.
It's funny that you say that, because, you know, I'm gonna give you a reference from the show Friends. I don't know if you watched that, but there's a character called Chandler, and nobody among his friends group know what he does for a living. That's me, because I don't think most of the people in my life know what I do for a living. They just think that I play around with computers and do some things, but they really don't know what I exactly do.
That about sums it up.
So the story is actually very... The story is funny too, that how I got started into bioinformatics. So, so to give you a little bit of background, I have a bachelor's degree in microbiology, and I did that in from Mumbai University in India. And as I was, so we had like these lab classes that we had to do practicals, and we had that very early in the morning. So one morning I was just driving myself, you know, to the class. And there was this poster on the stairs that talked about these, they were basically accepting these abstracts for these poster sessions. And the department that was organizing is from a different college, and the department was bioinformatics. And that word was the first time when I read that word, and I was very intrigued. I was like, what is this word? What does that even mean? You know? And I always had like a predilection towards computers, even though I was in microbiology. And then that, during that time, I'm talking about 2011. So nobody even remotely talked about computers and biology together. So I was very intrigued by that word, and I just went up to the Google and I searched, and that led me to, you know, reading up about what is bioinformatics. And that was like kind of a eureka moment for me, that I found something, the best of both the worlds coming together, and that such a field existed. And that was such a revelation for me, and I was so excited. And I started reading up more about it. What were the colleges? What were the programs? What is the scope? Although I didn't have much idea, to be honest, because I was still very early on in my career. I didn't understand a lot of things. So, but one thing for sure at that age I knew was that this is the field, or this is the exact intersection I want to be. This is the intersection for me, and this is something that I would want to take it ahead. So it all started from there.
That's cool.
Poster on the stair.
that's yeah. I mean, again, I think everybody that loves bioinformatics loves that fact that it's like you get to mix those worlds together. Like it's like they're synthesizing together. How early on did you notice you like tech, And how early on did you notice you liked like biology? Like, I'm just curious. Cause like, if you went down the microbiology route, clearly like you felt at the time, you know, that biology was like more of the thing, but you always also had that itching for like tech. So I'm just curious, like.
So I think it was from the school, from the school. So I think when I was in my eighth grade, seventh grade, I think early on when, you know, you start getting introduced to biology, start taking biology seriously. I don't know, maybe it could be different for everyone, but I think it was from the school because I used to participate in these school projects and we had these school inter-school competitions where I used to like present posters and projects and all of that. So I used to participate in that. And since my parents, both of them had a degree in science.
Oh, really?
I think I was always like, you know, I'm ultimately an Indian kid, so you know the importance of STEM in our household. So we were always like, you know, kind of conditioned to think about science and, you know, something to do.
Engineering or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I think that was not very surprising that I would be inclined towards biology, but computers was a little different story because I think it was way early on. I don't want to reveal my age because I don't want to sound old, but it was the time when we had those Windows 99 computers.
Yes.
With the entire box thingy that comes.
Yeah. Imagine that, a computer with a box on it.
And we had floppy
TVs with a box. Oh my
God. Yeah. I am revealing my age in a way. So I think that kind of always intrigued me with computers and, you know, how things worked. And I think one quality which in retrospect, now I realize that I always had that was the curiosity. So if something broke or there was something that was not working in my computer, I would fix it. Like I would want to like look up the ways to fix it. So I think that, I don't know, kind of like fueled me into getting to know more about how computers work. And on the parallel, I was also interested in biology, but I never thought that these worlds would mix because like that was a very bizarre idea back then.
Yeah, of course. I mean, who would have thought, like, now you got me thinking about old computers too. I was just working on a Windows 95 computer and it blew my mind. I was like, whoa, this is crazy. Like, wow. Yeah, it's quite remarkable how things have like come together, and like obviously with like the advancing of personal computing and all that, like it's just pushing the boundaries of bioinformatics.
I mean, imagine data science, how far it has come. We started from 95, 99, XP professional. I don't even know that these terms are relevant today.
My gosh.
And then today we are at an age that we have chat GPT where you could just chat with a computer and gives you answer. Like that is crazy.
It's kind wild.
Exactly.
It's amazing though. Like it's beautiful and amazing, but also like kind of scary and like mind-blowing and like whoa, like what. But that's really cool. I'm so glad you like came across that, because like now you get to do both, you know. It's so cool.
And I think now now I feel it has become a sort of a mandatory skill, like, you know.
Really?
Earlier, I feel having a background in tech, or not even a background, but some experience with tech is going to be important moving forward. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because a lot of fields are introducing analytics, data processing, and collecting data. You know, these skills are going to be very in demand going ahead. Not to mention prompt engineering, since we have ChatGPT, but I'm sure you can talk more about it because you're coming from the other end of the spectrum, you know. And I would also be interested in knowing your journey, like since both of us came from the exact opposite and we ended together, and you have plans to take up bioinformatics. I would be interested to know what got you interested in bioinformatics, since you had no biology background.
Well, I definitely agree. Like speaking with other people, you know, like that the data science and like security are just really going to be pushed even more, just because, as you said, everything is collecting data. And so at some point it's not even about how to collect data, it's about how to like give meaning to that data, how to interpret data, how to pick out the parts you want in this ocean, vast ocean of all this data. So definitely you're absolutely like spot on in terms of, I do think it does kind of just continue being this demand for tech, even in jobs that you're like, oh, you would never need tech for that. But like, you didn't need tech to be like a secretary. And then it's like, well, no, now you need to use a computer to like schedule things. Like, it's like,
exactly.
It's just part of how we're going to do things. Now, and I'm also curious, like, I'm excited to see how it plays out in terms of AI. Like, it'll be interesting to see how, like, okay, like, we're using machine learning and algorithms to, like, create these programs, but then we can also create these programs to, like, perhaps start better interpreting this data, and then it exponentially gets better. Like, I'm curious to see how that's going to play out. It'll be really interesting for sure. Now, as for starting in bioinformatics, so originally, actually, I heard of the word for the first time. So if you can't tell, I like books. So I happened to stumble across this book.
That's a big looking book. I don't think I haven't seen that book.
So apparently this book is like a well-known book that they use to teach out of like a fair amount of like universities. But that was the first time I came across the book. Though at the time, I wasn't like necessarily looking for, like, at that point in my life, I was thinking, oh, I'll probably go more like biomedical for graduate school, or like, you know, like I'm exploring something there. So I didn't really know bioinformatics. And then like someone explained to me what it was. Like, I was telling someone, hey, look, I'm interested in grad school, but I come from a computer science background. They're like, oh, why don't you just do bioinformatics? And I was like, whoa, what are you talking about? And so let me backtrack here. So this is the first time I like saw the words bioinformatics, and I happened to come across it in like a nice little old bookshop, really cute spot. Then from there, I was interested. I knew I wanted to do something bio and techie somehow. Mm-hmm. So I just enrolled in a few classes at university. From there, showed interest with the professor. That professor led me to another professor who's like head of like a lab. Mm-hmm. And that's when I, you know, just sort of shared my story of, look, I come from tech, but I want to do biology, you know, maybe biomedical. I was like, nah, you got to do bioinformatics. Like, of course. I was like, what is that? And then I went home, looked up bioinformatics, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is it. This is exactly what I want to do. And then I happened to go back to the bookstore like later on. And so I actually picked up the book, and I was like, that's crazy. I saw this book and I was like, oh, it's whatever. And then it's like, now that's like the thing that's like, I have to be doing. Like, it's just like, wow, that's wild. So yeah, my story was just exploring biology till I kind of just hit bioinformatics right on the head. And so, I mean, that's really my journey, just sort of asking questions, being curious, and then not being afraid to reach out to like your professors or whoever you're working with, and you know, either send them an email or talk to them in person, office hours, whatever, and show that you're interested, show that you want to do the things you want to do, you know, like, because yeah, with that class, I always ask questions. So she already knew who I was. And so she like, I'm assuming she put in like a good word, like, oh yeah, you know, it's, you know, I would assume at least like a decent student, you know, and oh, okay. And then, so when he interviewed me, it was like right away, oh yeah, you're like, you're good. Come on, let's start. Wow. I was like, oh wow. Okay, cool. Now, of course, the lab I'm in is more microbiology, but you know, the plan is to keep getting more trained up for, you know, bioinformatics and such. Now, before we move on, I want to ask, what would you say, because you know, there's many like what's that word, like emphasis or concentrations within the field of biology. So what got you interested in microbiology?
I don't know, I was always fascinated with understanding the world of organisms that we don't see with our eyes. So you know, I did enroll in a program where I had to take classes from zoology, botany, studying plants and animals. But I don't know, I somehow always got very fascinated with, so I did do lab work, like, you know, when I was in, as a part of my undergrad, we had to take lab classes and we were like growing these organisms. Something that really intrigued me was bioluminescence, the concept of bioluminescence in microbiology. Like, these are these organisms that generate light using luciferase enzyme. I do remember some of my microbiology classes. So that was something that really got me intrigued. That how is it like, how do these tiny creatures, which are not even these sophisticated, they don't have sophisticated organ system on, you know, these processes that we have, but they're so intelligent. Even really these organisms who get, you know, these Staph aureus, who gets, you know, resistant to multiple drugs. And that's so fascinating to me that they don't have a complex processing. How in the world do they understand that this is a mutation I have to do so that I can get resistant to this antibiotic, I mean. And then there are like a combination of antibiotics, and I'm going to even get resistant to that.
That's, I know, it's so wild.
So complex. If you have to design, let's say if you're given all the resources, and if you have to design an organism, imagine the amount of processing that you would have to put into that organism for it to be able to learn, to adapt.
How to do that. It's just
amazing.
It's wild, right?
Exactly. Like now that we're talking, it's just like blows my mind away. And it always blew my mind. So I think I could divide my life before microbiology and after microbiology, because I think I got a lot more interested in science even after microbiology. I think until that point, I was still younger to kind of understand the complexity. So I did get into it with an initial interest, because a lot of time as students, the curiosity gets us in. But a lot of time we may not stick to it, because that couldn't live up to our expectations. But I think microbiology did blew my mind, and it just got me super excited about science. And then it fueled me further to like take it up ahead and go into bioinformatics and see how we can apply computation to kind of process such amazing data and generate insights. So I guess it is all kind of linked one after the other.
I totally understand that. I mean, like, okay, so the lab I'm working at, microbiology, I was like, oh, you know, it might not apply to me, but cool. Like, if, you know, like, if people ever give you opportunities, brother, I'm just putting it out there. If people ever give you opportunities, even if it's not necessarily the 100% the one you want, look, just take it, because you're better off working with people who believe in you and will give you these opportunities than working in what you might quote unquote think is like the perfect role, the perfect job or whatever, but with people who might not necessarily believe in you as much, or, you know, like give you these opportunities as often.
And what you just said is golden, actually. So a lot of times people would just like filter out their options on the basis of like little preliminary knowledge. I'm not saying people always do that. This is just like, you know, like most students would just like filter out their opportunities. But sometimes it just surprises you. It really, you sometimes don't know what you're really good at. So what you just said, I really agree and resonate with that. That sometimes the opportunity just strikes.
It's just
there. And it just hits the right chord with you, and that just takes you somewhere where you didn't see yourself going, you know.
Absolutely. And so like with the microbiology, I was like, oh, like, all right, like we'll see how this goes. And now, like you said, I'm learning about like all these little tiny organisms who have like these amazing abilities. So like I'm studying like, for example, Bacillus subtilis, and it's a natural competency. And like, I'm trying to like reading more on it, but like the basics, you know, just in case, you know, not everybody knows competency. It's like the ability for the organism to take up DNA in its surrounding environment. Like, think about how cool that is. That's like saying, like, if I touch you right now, like we're exchanging DNA, genetic information. That is wild. Exactly. What are you talking about? And so in other words, like you said, it develops these resistance to drugs. It can acquire these new genes and pretty much give it these superpowers. Like, that is wild, you know? And so like now it's gotten me really fascinated to do something with like microbiome. Like, I would love to do like data sets and such for like microbiome, like for grad school. That's definitely something now I'm like, okay, that's cool.
That would be super cool. Yeah.
It was wild. Like, and I happened to be reading a paper like earlier this week. And it was talking about just like one sentence at the end about how Bacillus subtilis has like applications for like Alzheimer's disease and all that. And I was like, oh my gosh, that is wild. Like, this little thing that's just in your gut, because yes, it's a probiotic, can
apparently, I hate to cut you off, But it got me like super excited when I read about the gut and the brain axes. There's
yes.
a lot of connection and there's yes. so much research that's going on.
Mm-hmm.
But that would be super cool, right? If you do yes. some, like if you do your research in that and if you like study that would be like super cool.
I'm excited. Like I'm going to make that my mission to do for grad school, like something mm-hmm. microbiome. Now, if you can be but still a subtlist, that'd be great. I get it. You know, when you apply, it's just kind of like, up to mm-hmm. you and your PI, but definitely plan on like you see, like continuing that microbiology that I thought would like never have any relevance. Like I definitely plan on continuing that throughout grad school. So
I would love if you can send me some papers that you're reading currently, and if you found them exciting, I would love to read up on that, because although yes. I don't work with bacteria or these organisms mm-hmm. anymore, that definitely has like a very soft spot in my heart, and I can't. Okay. It's always going to be super exciting for
you
me.
You got so. It. Oh my God. Like I'll send you the paper. It's like Bacillus subtilis, the Swiss Army knife of like science and biotech. Like I'll send it to you and I'll make sure to throw a link as well. Mm-hmm. But it's so cool. Like it talks about all these applications of like obviously one, it was talking about like it being a useful probiotic. It was talking about another one mm-hmm. where it's like bio mining, like bios, mm-hmm. something like that, where like you can use the bacteria in like this, like I forget if it's like some sort of glue concoction or something mm-hmm. to restore concrete. So like it can be used to like
help oh.
What are you talking? Like what are you talking about? Right? Like it's like
oh my god,
what?
Okay.
They talked about you can use it like for like your livestock, of course. They're talking mm-hmm. about a few other ones but that concrete one just blew my mind. I'm like, wait, I thought we were talking about this little bacteria, now we're talking about concrete, like
concrete,
what, like
yeah.
what? So I'll make sure to definitely throw it your way, but yeah, it blew my mind. Like
there's this another phenomena that got me really excited when I got to first know about it. So there's something called as quorum sensing.
There's something what
called quorum sensing.
Quorum sensing.
And the phenomena and I could be completely off because this is something I studied about like years ago,
mm-hmm.
but I think what I remember from it is that these bacteria, when they come into a sort of some numbers or quorum, mm-hmm. they're able to demonstrate a group activity which benefits everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So the benefit of them getting together is more when they get together rather than for each individual. So it's kind of like a group activity, a coordination or a cooperation between these organisms.
That's cool.
And you remember, I remember the last time we spoke and you talked about sapiens, and it brings me that to that point that you will know Noah Harari talks about how human beings are the only species, or technically correct, Homo sapiens are the only species that can mm-hmm. actually coordinate in larger groups. There are no mm-hmm. other animals or organisms that can coordinate in larger groups for a betterment for, you know, so, and that benefits the entire group. So that was kind of amazing that how these tiny microbes are doing that as well. Not like large numbers, but at mm-hmm. least to the point that that's benefiting the community or whatever the quorum that they are forming. I mean, that is very interesting idea that we are talking about very complex organisms, Homo mm-hmm. sapiens, and then we're talking about very primitive, not primitive, but very simple one-cell organisms.
Mm-hmm.
And how are they demonstrating similar phenomena? Like, that is something that is
it's wild.
Amazing. Yeah, it just seems unreal sometimes.
It how does.
How is that possible?
It is. And they're, like, working inside you. Like, they're, like, part of humans, like just they're in there doing a thing, like just like,
and they form an integral part of your body. The gut microbiome is a very important part of your body.
If you have papers that you would recommend, please send them my way. We'll include them in links as well, because I think I feel like you've read like quite some few papers. You're like, all right, like
this is all years ago. I could be completely wrong. I mean, a lot of research would have been done, and I would be. This is something that I'm quoting. Like years ago, but I would really want to read up more about these things, but unfortunately, since I don't work on bacterial genomes anymore, I don't read a lot, but mm-hmm. definitely if I come across something very interesting, I'm gonna definitely
Brilliant.
Send it with you. Yeah,
cool, thank you. And so I'm also curious in terms of, because we mentioned grad school, what was your decision process like between like master's or PhD? Because for some people, it can be like, oh my gosh, I'm not sure what to choose. Some people are like, nope, straight master's, or nope, straight PhD. Like, so what was your path like?
The age-old dilemma of master's versus PhD.
Yeah.
So for me, I think what was the decision-making for me to do my master's was, after master's, I want to gauge my interest. So I didn't want to make a longer commitment and then end up hating it, because I was still wanting to gauge my interest in the field, that would I be still interested in bioinformatics after I pursue a graduate program? Would I still be interested? So would I be okay committing to a 5-year program? Would I be okay to committing to a 2-year program? That was the most basic consideration for me, that was I am I able to commit to this study for this much amount of time? You know, is this something that's going to hold my interest? So I think that was the reason I did my master's. After my master's, once I completed my master's, there were some of my you know, friends who wanted to do PhD. They were very clear about it, that they wanted to do PhD. There were some who wanted to be get into a job, like, you know, industry or whatever. But for me, I still wasn't sure do I want to do a PhD? Do I want to get a job? So I think what I did, and I think that worked out the best for me, that I took up a job in academia, even though I didn't have a PhD. So usually the route is, if you are pursuing for a PhD, most likely you would want to grow in academia. If you are taking the master's route, you could be in academia, you could transition to industry position as well. Not to say that PhDs don't transition to industry, not to say. But I think staying in academia at the master's level did give me a very deep insight on how academia works. What are the intricacies of academia? Do I then want to pursue a PhD and continue that? Or do I want to, you know, switch to the other side, get the ideas of both the worlds, and then make the decision? I think I'm still in that zone right now where I'm figuring it out.
Okay.
But I guess I have a pretty fair idea on which way I want to go. Right now, I'm happy being in academia. And I think the kind of work in academia and industry also differs. So right now, I'm really loving the work that I'm doing in academia. But in the future, I may, you know, switch over to industry. I may or may not. I don't know that. So that was my exact thought process at how I approached to, you know, staying in master's and, you know, if, whether I would want to go to a PhD or just stay in master's. I think that's my idea of the whole process.
Gotcha. Okay. So master's more so if you want a smaller commitment, but also like if you're more so industry, and then PhD more so if you're considering academia?
I don't want to rigidly say that because I'm going to get a lot of backlash. So I don't want to rigidly say that, but I think I would put it again. And also there's another aspect to it. So there are people who are very passionately, you want to passionately add more to the knowledge base in the research. They want to contribute to research. At that stage and age when I graduated master's, I didn't really know if I had any solid ideas, or I wasn't that passionate. If I'm being very honest, I wasn't very passionate whether I would want to contribute to research. I guess I was just like gauging my options and gauging my interest, how I wanted to go about it.
Yeah, of course.
But I think one thing staying in academia is what I realized, that you need to have a PhD in order to go up the ladder and take up. So basically you could do a PhD and get like a postdoc position. You could eventually grow up to be, you know, grow up in the ladder and, you know, be an assistant professor, take a faculty position, or you could completely switch over to the industry side and be an engineer or an analyst or a staff scientist, you know. So
absolutely,
these are the different options.
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. Cause I mean, so was this in the States or was this in India in terms of grad school?
Both actually. Both? So okay. I did 2 masters.
Oh, really?
In bioinformatics. Yes. That's a little known fact. So I did 1 master's in India, master's in bioinformatics. And I realized that there was a gap in, the kind of skills that was required. and the kind of skills that I was taught. And again, the program that I enrolled in was fairly new and they lacked infrastructure. So I felt there was a need for me to pursue a master's again, because I still at that point wasn't sure that I would really want to go into PhD after that. So I enrolled into another master's. So that was the second master's was in US.
Oh, okay. And just because I ask, it's like, I know like the time span for like each of the degrees varies also like based on the country. So like,
exactly.
I know in the States, I was just talking to someone like a PI informatics. She was saying like for PhD, they aim for 5 years, but it's still on average about six. Mm-hmm. Whereas a master's is about 2 to 3 years, you know? So right off the bat, yeah, that's definitely something to consider. Because remember, I mean, for the most part, you're not really getting paid much for the PhD, and then for the master's, depending where you go, you're actually paying to do a master's. There's to what I've seen, there's very few like paid masters, like where you to do a master's.
Thesis. And that's so, how I saw it as well, you know. So
yeah,
6 years, let's say 5 years, 5 years of PhD, 2 years of master's, and 3 years of experience. Yeah. That's how I saw it.
Yeah,
if I'm being very honest.
Yeah, no, but absolutely.
Not to say that PhD is not a good deal. I think if you, it's great because it really advances your career if you really want to go into academia. I think that's the best choice if you want to go into academia.
Would you say, because I've heard different things from different people as well in terms of like, if you do a PhD, sometimes you could also be too specialized for, but I also feel like, well, bioinformatics, like, you know, maybe, I think, I don't know, like I've seen, you know, it's a little more known to like get a PhD like in like careers of like bioinformatics, data science, things like that. I don't know if you, like what are your thoughts, maybe what have you seen of like what is a PhD like too specialized, or just, you know, or you think that's kind of maybe baloney, like, and you can still just work anywhere more specifically for industry, obviously for academia, like
for PhD industry, I don't really, and I could be wrong here, but as far as my observation has been, I think industry, it wouldn't matter much if you have a PhD. I think what matters is your experience and the kind of skill set that you have, you know. I think in terms of specialized, when you say that you become very specialized, it goes for both, right? Like for industry, let's say if you're working for a company, a startup company, and they're working on a product, again, that's going to be very specific. Like you're going to be working with one kind of data and analyzing that or making the product better. I think that would also be specialized. I think where I am is the best of both the worlds, because I, with my master's, since I am working as a scientist in a lab, I get to work on projects where the question is different every time. So maybe that's something that I got to, that's the reason that I got to grow my skill set and work with different. So I think in terms of specialization, I wouldn't put it that PhD is more specific. I think industry also becomes specific after some point.
I appreciate that perspective. You're right. Because, you know, as the more time you're in like a your role, like, of course, you're going to learn more about the ropes and dive deeper into that specific thing, you know.
Yeah.
But you're also making some nice money from it, you know, and like you're developing other skill sets like outside of academia. So it's different. But that's definitely something to consider. All right. And so for someone entering bioinformatics from the biology side, I'm sure it can feel overwhelming in terms of like what tools one should learn to use and how to use them, and you know, etc. So if you were speaking to like a class of biologists right now, like let's say undergraduate biologists, you know, they're all interested in bioinformatics, right? Like let's say it's a bioinformatics club, you know, what few, like 1 to 3 tools would you say, okay, this is where you first want, like, start here if you want to get into bioinformatics from biology into getting to know the tech?
I think the first and the most fundamental requirement is, and I don't know if you, I mean, I would be happy to get your thoughts on it, is programming. Because I think biology students don't have a background or, you know, any experience with programming. And I think most of them are very scared. So I think in a class full of people, I would be like, the first thing I would say is, for bioinformatics, you need programming. You can't do bioinformatics without programming.
Okay.
The second thing I would say is that programming is not hard. That is, That is one biggest misconception people have, that it's very tough. I guess what the challenge is with biologists is that programming has a very, how do I say it? It's completely out of their comfort zone. So I think people are more scared to venture out and, you know, put in the amount of time that you would need to put in to get grasp those basic computational concepts, right? You know, that's the second thing that I would say. So I think putting in that time is going to, the returns of that is unimaginable. I think once you put in that time to learn one programming language, and I think that is something you would agree with me, that you learn one programming language, you can grasp any other programming language.
Yeah.
The constructs are basically the same. It's not like the way you write a for loop is going to be different syntactically, but conceptually it's the same thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think the second thing is what I'm going to say is that it's not hard. And I think you need to put time to learn it, because that is going to help you and really help you grasp these concepts better. The third thing I'm going to say is get familiar with Linux, because you know what I'm talking about, right?
Yes, precisely.
Like, yeah. So get used to, make Linux your best friend. You know, just spend time working in that operating, because I feel that is, now that I've worked so much in Linux, I feel that is more intuitive than you know, graphical user interface. I would prefer a command line tool any day over the graphical interface.
Yes.
Especially when you're dealing with large data, I think.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so much easier. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Now,
so when these are some of the things that I would talk about. Yeah.
And so when you say programming languages, like back to the first one, when you say programming languages, there's so many, because people come to me like, oh, you know, this SQL, that Java. That. What would you recommend would be, okay, like from your perspective, right? Coming from biology into tech, like, okay, like you feel like this is a good first step for programming.
I don't want to like take up much of your time, but I just want to quickly mention that I started my journey with C. I learned C, I learned C++, I learned Perl. I have tried across the spectrum.
Yes.
But I tell you, if you have code, if you have learned to code in C, your programming basics are going to be very clear.
Which is why I am such a big advocate. Python should not be your first
program. The first language. Exactly.
It should not. It should be C or C++. Exactly. Because you really understand what and how your code works. Because Python, it does, you know, all these other extra things for you. Whereas C, C++, you have to do everything yourself and really understand at that lower level, like how your code actually works. Exactly. It seems intimidating. It does. I will admit, it looks a little intimidating. But with enough time, I mean, come on, biology is like, there's so many different worlds and parts of biology. If you study biology, C++ is a piece of cake. It's just, you know, little lines of, you know, of text. Like it doesn't even compare. I feel like biology is so much harder, because just because there's such a large vast of things to know, and they all interplay together.
Exactly.
Whereas with C++, it's just, if you know that, you're good. Like, you know, like that, and it translates to everything else.
Exactly, it translates to everything. So I think learning Python would be like learning sentences without learning vowels and consonants. I think it's important to learn the basics. I
love that description. Thank you. Just thank you so much. Like, that description is perfect. You're absolutely right.
Yeah. So I feel I'm very glad that I put in that amount of time to understand C. Understand the basic concepts, and once you get those concepts in C and C++, you're gonna thank yourself, because then you can pick up any language. It doesn't matter. You can code in Ruby, you can code in Python, you can code in R. Yeah. If there's Julia, you can code in Julia. I think it doesn't matter. Then it just becomes immaterial, you know, because you can achieve the same thing in any other programming language. And even to understand any other programming language would be easier for you.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Actually, sometimes I do find myself struggling in terms of like with Python, just because like it does so much for you that I'm like, oh, wait, like it's doing all this other stuff in the background. Like, wait, what? No, don't do that. I just wanted it to do this one thing.
Like, one thing,
it's doing
yeah.
five other things. I'm like, wait, no, hold on, slow down. But I'm also.
So what programming language do you code in?
No, C++. I like C++. Oh, okay. Yeah, no, I'm a big advocate of C++.
Yeah.
But, oh, wait, where is it going with this?
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. Okay. So, but I'm also, okay. Yes. Yes. So I'm also a big advocate of like assembly language. So like, I know like, mm-hmm. like people have like, it's known that assembly language is like really hard and it's not, but I also think it's really fun too. Cause you learn even more of like how the hardware and like the parts work together. And like, mm-hmm. it's just, it's now I'm not saying go learn assembly language. I'm not saying. That's like another layer, like lower. Yeah. I'm not saying go learn assembly mm-hmm. language. I'm not, okay. But it definitely helps in understanding just how all the other languages really like think exactly. and like function.
Mm-hmm. You know? So, exactly.
And then if you know, those of you listening like are open to learning C++, I don't know if I have it here. Maybe not. But there's this would it be here? C++ primer. Oh, I don't have my other one. So it's my favorite C++ book, but it's called it's by D.S. Malik. It's like mm-hmm. C++ like data structures and something, but it's by D.S. Malik, M-A-L-I-K. I highly recommend that book if like you're mm-hmm. intimidated by C++ and you want like baby steps and you want like examples of like the programs. And I think it's a really great book. Now, of course, you know, at this point, people probably don't even read books, so it's fine. You know, you can go online as well and just look up C++ tutorials. I mean, I think they're really great. Now, a language I would also recommend, right, to get comfortable with, of course, mm-hmm. would be just like getting comfortable, like you said, with Linux and like bash scripting.
Oh,
like
really being able to absolutely. Mm-hmm. Like just, I miss that, yeah.
Just because it's so important, like, because, yeah. right, like just taking in all this data and like being able to like, it's crucial. So I would definitely say if you're really dedicated and you know, like you're going to do bioinformatics and programming, I would say hold off on Python just mm-hmm. because if you learn C and C++, you really learn how to program. Mm-hmm. Then from there, also learn some bash scripting and then start brushing up on Python because Python will be so much easier. Like, it's really mm-hmm. just a matter of don't be lazy. Just read the documentation. Like, you know, just you got to do it.
It does everything for you. I mean,
it Python does, which is for me is function. So annoying. Like, it's like, ah, I just wanted it to do this one thing and now it's doing all these other things. I don't know why.
I shouldn't be saying that because I use R, which kind of has functions for everything. So I don't really go to the base
gotcha. Level okay.
scripting. So I kind of, I'm in no position to say that because I'm using R, so I use R on day-to-day basis. So I think, yeah, it does. But I think it's more important for especially the students who want to get into bioinformatics to understand mm-hmm. the programming aspect, because that is a very crucial. The informatics part of coming from the programming is a crucial aspect of yeah. the subject. Just as biology.
So. Yeah.
And I just want to add one more point, sorry.
No, go.
Before I just lose the thought, I just wanted to add one more thing. Yeah. That learning C and C++ also helps you understand how efficient, memory efficient these programming languages are. That's mm-hmm. memory efficient is another big factor, which, you know, you have to consider when you're dealing with large data set. And these languages,
gigabytes,
bash scripting.
Yes.
Oh, you try opening a 10 gigs file in Linux and try opening a 10 gigs file in R or Python.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I mean, that was the first few weeks I started with, I'm like, whoa, okay, this is like larger data sets. Okay, this isn't just like, oh, a file. Like, no, this is gigabytes of data. I was like, okay, we're going to have to like go back to basics here. And mm-hmm. yeah. And I know we said like a lot of different like programming languages, but again, I'll iterate, if you're coming from bio, and you're trying to get into the informatics side, and like my recommendation, learn C or C++, definitely learn some bash scripting. And then from there, like once you learn those two fundamentals, mm-hmm. then I would say, okay, yeah. go look at Python, go look at R. And if you know C++, you pretty much know Java.
Yeah.
And I think with that, I mean, you'll be solid. Like, yeah. But you got to start with that fundamentals. Even if C++ is like, still scaring you, fine. Then just start with bash scripting. Mm-hmm. Get really comfortable with that, you know? Like, it's a very useful tool. And even if, like, all right, like, I'm not saying quit on bioinformatics, but even outside of the world of bioinformatics, like knowing that skill set, if you want to ever go into like, you know, like the tech world of things, like it's just, it's really crucial. Like, and I remember when I was first told to learn, I was like, I don't want to learn that. You know, it's like, that's like for like, you know, old software, like old computer, like, oh, that's just like, why would I learn that? And then now I'm like, oh, I'm so glad like people pushed me to like,
that's a very important point. A lot of people think that it's outdated. Nobody uses it. I was like, that's besides the point. That's not the point that people use it or no. It's just important for you to understand how things work.
Exactly. Yeah. No, for sure. And then, but then it's funny that I had that mindset with Bash, right? Because you like with C++, like I was so embracing it. Oh my gosh, I love that. Like, like it's a challenge because I'm really into like if something's challenging, oh yes, like that's fun, you know, it's worth the adventure, if you will. And then like getting to learn how all this hardware works, like, oh yes, cool. Now from the other perspective, I would love to know, like from tech going into bio, what tools or recommendations would you recommend one first learn, like in terms of the biology world?
This is harder for me because I'm not the one transitioning from tech to bio. So,
but you've been through the tunnel. Like my thing is, you've been through the tunnel. You've seen all these different worlds of biology. So like, okay, like for you, what would be like? Okay, obviously you got to know this. Like I would imagine, like, you know, probably genetics, right? Like you got to know. Right.
I think the rule would be the same, right? Learn the fundamentals first, because I think if you don't understand the fundamentals of any topic or any subject, you're not going to understand what is going to happen later on. So if you directly jump on DNA replication without knowing what a DNA is, I think that is just, you know, missing the point. So I think for biology, I think there are so many great resources online, even on YouTube. We have Khan Academy. I think there's so many beautiful videos and resources where they talk about like high school level biology and they take you up from there. I think it's important to understand, especially in bioinformatics, as you said, genetics is something I would be, you know, but again, the genetics would be, so I would say learn the basics, if not the details, because genetics would differ with the kind of organism or data you're dealing with. So you would require to read up on it. Another thing that I think is very crucial, especially for someone to come from tech, is apart from learning fundamentals, is to read up on the research, read up the literature. I think there's a lot of books sometimes don't keep up with the updates in the literature. I think it's important that anytime you come across a topic which you're not familiar with, I would say go to literature first, like go to the research paper first, read up the background. I think they have done their background. The background would be well updated and suited for you to understand what is the issue that they're trying to address, what is the biology behind it, what is the question. I think that would be a good source to get like a general idea on that topic. And once that you don't understand that, okay, this is the concept I'm not familiar with, you can go back to the basics and read up or, you know, watch the videos. I think that's the approach that I would recommend.
Absolutely. I mean, that's definitely one thing I'm learning. Like, if you're going to be in science, like, I don't know how it is for other sciences, but definitely for like biology, you got to read papers. Like, and that's something I'm learning. I'm just like, oh my gosh, these papers are so difficult. Hanging, like I feel like I'm on the other end of like, okay, like people find programming like intimidating. I find research papers intimidating because I'll start reading and it uses these words, but, and I'm just like, what? And then I have to like Google every other word.
There's a way to read. So okay.
So okay, how would you recommend? How would you recommend approaching and reading a research paper?
So I could be super super bashed.
But how do you do it? Right, because everybody has their own approaches to it.
So, okay, let's say if I'm reading up something that I'm reading up for the first time without any goal in my mind that, okay, this is something that I want to, I would first understand what is the question that they are asking, you know, what is the biological question? So that requires me to read up the abstract, the introduction and discussion and conclusion. I would just read that. So that would give me the gist of the paper. Like, what did they do? What was the information available? What was the question? Why did they decide to do this research? So what was the gap in the research or the knowledge that they tried to answer using this paper? And, you know, what did they find out at the end of the study? So that's the entire paper summarizing. Without methods, without going into the results, I would just read these parts. If you're further interested in how they did that, like how exactly they answered that question, then you would essentially go into the results.
Okay.
Results, basically, these are the results that are supporting their findings, and that's how they concluded that, you know, this particular study answers that question. Now, exactly how they did that, the steps would be the methods. So it again depends on what you're looking for. You might not necessarily have to read the entire paper. I'm not encouraging people to not read paper, like the entire paper, but I'm just saying that.
That's what I'm hearing. You said we don't have to read the paper. It's just, you know, just certain parts.
Yeah. If especially you just want to get like the gist of the paper, you can just read these sections. If you're interested in the methods and the results, how did they, what were the findings that basically supported, you can go into the results and the methods. But if you're trying to, like, you know, replicate or reproduce a study, then you have to go through the entire paper.
You know, I appreciate that. I because a lot of people, like, how to put this into words, you know, like you have to think about what is the purpose of what you're doing to some degree, right? Like, because, like, I'm sure people reach out to you, like, for like bioinformatics, like a career advice or something, like, or like, you know, advice on like schooling or etc. Like, but it's like, but first you have to think, like, what do you want? Like, what do you, what is your story and like your experiences, and what do you like, where are you at and what are you trying to aim at? And then from there you can sort of create this plan of like, all right, plan of attack to like work towards that goal. But it's like, if you don't like have that self-talk with yourself, like, okay, I want to learn more about bacillus, you know, and okay, biotech, you know, ideas in mind. All right, cool. What I want to read. All right, I'll probably just read like the discussion sections of like its applications and maybe that's it. But if you want to, like you said, replicate it, well, yeah, then you got to really understand the methods. Maybe even, I would say even, right, read like the results to see like, okay, like this is what they did and this is what they got, like why perhaps, you know.
So, and sometimes it's also important for you to critique. So, you know, it's not just taking them by the word. It's also thinking that, okay, they did this experiment and they got these results. Does the result make sense? Are the results relevant to answering the question that they're asking? A lot of times study publish these results, a lot of it are not relevant or are not accurate. Or, you know, there are a lot of technicalities that they don't pay attention to. I would say approach a research paper with a critical mind. Don't take it as it is. But the good part is that you can use the background as a good starting point to understand the subject. Because they would have definitely done a background literature review and they added that as the background to explain the biological problem. So that would be a good starting point. But I think approach a research paper with a critical mind. Don't take it to the T. Because I think, and it's not right or wrong in research. I think it's a part of the process.
And it's just information. Yes.
It's just information, exactly.
Yes.
So, yeah.
That is one thing that I try to tell people, like, just completely off topic, but like, in terms of like, when you have thoughts or ideas or whatever, like, you don't need to judge them. Like, they're just what they are. You know, like, because like I have this thing where like I like to like write down like ideas or whatever, like, just why not, like, why not collect them, you know? But like, don't judge them, like, just like they're your own thoughts and ideas, like, just write them down and they are what they are. Same with information, like, don't look like it's good or bad. It's just like, take it, you know, analyze it, whatever, and like, it just is what it is, you know.
Exactly.
Just a little tidbit there.
And I just also wanted to add, sorry.
No, go for it.
Now that we're talking about research papers, I also want to add, it's very, very, very crucial to, you know, read papers from high impact factor journals.
From where?
High impact factor journals.
Oh, okay.
So you should also be cognizant of that fact that this paper was published in what journal. What kind of studies have cited this paper, because that can also give you an idea on how impactful that research is.
I see.
You know, because a lot of times, you know, when you are venturing into a new topic that you know you don't know about, it would be a good measure to get an idea on how popular this research is. Have people in the same field use this research? Have they used this knowledge? I think it's important to also gauge that.
Okay.
you know, because a lot of times, you know, people would reach out to me, and there was this one incident where someone reached out to me, they sent me an article and they said that you said that this cannot be done, but this was being done in this research article. I said, like, yeah, but I understand that, but I'm not going to be very trustworthy of that research article because apparently it had, that journal had no impact factor and nobody used that paper, like nobody had used that research study.
Yeah.
So it kind of makes me question the credibility of the research. It kind of makes me question how much should I trust that study, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So it also has to be, you also have to be cognizant of these facts when you're reading a research paper.
Absolutely. It's weird, like, because coming from like programming, computer science, like things, I mean, granted, then again, they don't, but like things usually just work how they work. And they're usually like more so when you program, like the program works exactly how you tell it to. I mean, obviously I get it. Like sometimes a computer crashes or whatever, but like for the most part, it's like, it does what you tell it to do. But then like more so in the life sciences, it just has like its own existence. Like you expect, you know, this organism to behave like this, and then it just behaves like the complete opposite sometimes. And then you're like, wait, why did that happen? Like, what? Like, we expected this and we get this whole other thing. And then it's like, and imagine doing that with like pretty much every research that's going on with the life sciences. So I definitely, like, word of caution with the life sciences in terms of like, they don't, and again, this is kind of like me peeking in, it's like they don't necessarily work as you expect. It's just more of like things function and work, and then we're taught about this fascinating world of life sciences, and then we're just kind of thrown into like, all right, go like find like questions and answers to these things that we've observed over, you know, over our
and I think it also has to do with, so when you have to do an experiment and you know, there are more variables in your control. But when you do an experiment in the lab, there are so many things that you cannot control. Yeah. I think there are more factors playing a role in that, which could be causing a discrepancy. And you try to quantify that. But, you know, so I guess with life sciences, I think that's also one of the reasons why you see such unexpected results. And, you know, you wouldn't expect the organism to grow, but it's growing. So
it's, like, I never thought I would, like, well, one, I never thought I'd be working in a wet lab. I mean, that's just like, it's blowing my mind. Like, whoa. But I never thought I would have to like worry about like the air in terms of affecting the work that I do. Because I have, you know, I mean, again, I'm still fairly new to wet lab work. So, you know, I've had my fair share of like already contaminating some things. And it's just like, but I didn't put anything else in it. But of course, you're like, you know, you got to stay close to your flame and have your little, you know, what is it, like your safety bubble, your aseptic bubble thing. And then like, but little particles in the air can just go in and like contaminate your entire experiment. Exactly. And then now you gotta, you just wasted a whole day. And it's just like, what, that is wild, you know? Like, so yes, definitely keep into account, you know, just variables when it comes to, I'd say more so life sciences. I mean, I'm sure it applies everywhere, right? But like life sciences, just like, there's so many variables. Like, like if you just like lightly touch a pipette, that's it. Like you got to reset.
It's
like,
done.
Nope. Like because like just because you happen to have like a lightly loose glove or something, like, nope. So just you know, for those of you doing research, you know, hang in there, stay patient. For those of you interested in doing research or, you know, diving into this amazing world of biology, stay patient as well. You know, like it's definitely can be a learning curve from both sides, bio into tech into bio. But stay patient. Keep at it, stay consistent, and you'll get through it. Any other questions you have for me? I think that is all my questions. So, oh, actually, I have one more. I do have one more question. What is your, like, or just big picture overview process when you're like, coming up with content?
I think a lot of time, before I started the channel, I kind of just sat down one day and literally made a laundry list of all the concepts or whatever ideas I had in my mind, which for which I could not find content. And more importantly, it's not about finding content online. It's just about not being explained in a way that would be very intuitive to someone who has no idea on this field. You know, I think that was my major focus. And the idea was, more importantly, to create awareness as to what this field is, what does it entail, you know. And I hope that in the next few years, when I tell someone that I'm a bioinformatics scientist, I don't at least get a response that what is that? You know, yeah. I want to create awareness. That's that's the fundamental idea. So I guess my concentration process was just to make a list of these things and also get a lot of ideas from the feedback when people reach out to me in my comments or on emails, when people have questions, even the kind of questions they ask. Sometimes that gives me an idea that, oh, you know, this is something that needs to be explained. I just, because I've been in this field for like some time, I just kind of overlook the fact that, you know, this could be something that people might not understand.
You know? Okay, yeah.
So I think these are true. Yeah.
Like you'll be surprised like how much is part of like your own daily vocabulary, but then like other people don't know it. Cause trust me, like I'll put into context. I was a few weeks into my first biology class when I joined like my biology research lab, and they were talking, you know, it was inserted here and freaking we have the cloning vectors and plasmids. I'm like, what do you to what? Like, what what is bacteria? I think I know what that is. Okay, DNA, I think I kind of know what that is. And then, you know, just stay patient, but don't be afraid to ask questions. Like just ask or Google them, you know, or find resources to help you learn. If you prefer books, like use book, whatever you got to do to learn it, just go out and learn it. And don't be afraid to ask questions and stay curious.
I think that's the most important quality, I would say, that every young student should have, is being curious and asking questions, because I think that is going to take them way ahead. It's, you know, because if you ask the right question, you're going to get the answer. Yeah. It's just, it's not even about the answer, it's about the question. So if ask the right question, you're going to get the answer.
It really is. Yeah, the questions are really the hard part. What do we say, right? The questions,
are the hard part.
Because you just answer, it's like, well, I mean, this is, it already happened in the past and I'm just answering this question. But
really
coming up with that focused question of what, you know, you want the conversation to go and like, or what you want to discuss, it's definitely the hardest part. So stay curious. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Like, no matter how many, like, just keep asking them and keep going.
Yep.
Any questions you have for me?
Yeah, I'm very, since you're coming from the tech world, I wanted to know what were your challenges? You know, what were your specific challenges or something that you still struggle with today? It could be both tech and biology.
So definitely, I mean, I don't feel like I'm struggling necessarily with the tech side. I mean, obviously, like just from my background, I mean, I'm definitely brushing up on R. I've been using your tutorials to like get a better handle on R, because I used it a few years ago, but like it was very basic, like, and then after that, like I didn't dive into it as much. So right now I'm just brushing up on R. Python I've used for a while, and then fortunately like the last year I've been doing bash scripting, so none of that's really been crazy. I think the hardest tech side for me is just learning R. And by the way, you know, if you want to learn R, go check out Kushbu's like playlist, because it's really, really like practical, useful, very helpful. So thank you for the videos. Like, they're like really good in-depth videos, so I would highly recommend you go check them out. But now on the biology side, I think the hardest part is like just being patient, just because like I get frustrated not knowing things. Like, obviously I know I'm not gonna know everything, like that. That's just, you know, like we only got 100 years, you know, like, you know,
if you're being optimistic.
If you're, exactly, and that's like, okay, as soon as you come out of the womb, you're like,
that's a very pessimistic view, but I think I'm just like trying to put in some realism.
Yeah, I mean, I like to say, you know, we're like, we're gonna live to be about 100, you know, our medicine and all that's gonna continue advancing exponentially, like, so I like to be optimistic. But all right, let's say like, let's meet in the middle, let's say like 85, you know, is that better? Okay, all right, so you know, you're only gonna live to be 85, so you can't learn everything. And that's something I learned too, of like, you can do anything, but you can't do everything. So at some point, you kind of have to dial it down. Now, I'm not saying you can only do one thing. I'm actually a big believer of, there's so much one can do in life, especially now with the age of like the internet and data and everything. Mm-hmm. So I mean, I am a big fan of, no, embrace your different avenues of interest, right? Like mm-hmm. how you had your tech, but you also had biology. Like, who would have mm-hmm. thought, like, yeah, maybe 50, 100 years ago wouldn't really have been a thing. But nowadays, exactly. things are changing mm-hmm. so much that I am a big believer of, if you're, you know, a musician and a biologist and a technologist and a this and an artist, and all right, cool, do it. But make sure you're prioritizing those things and really nothing else. Like, prioritize yeah. the things that matter. Mm-hmm. Anyways, back to the original question. Staying patient in terms of, because it takes time to learn the biology. It takes time to read a research article. Like, it still takes me days to read through a research article, because I'm always like, it's like every other sentence I'm like looking up a word or looking up mm-hmm. an entire sentence, like, wait, what does this mean? But stay patient and stay consistent. So right now I still struggle with like just reading through research articles. Like, it's still mm-hmm. like, but I'm getting a little better at it, right? Like, so like I can get through maybe the first paragraph now without like maybe looking something up or whatever. So it's just time. That's after like I would say a few months of like trying to work yeah. through these articles, and because mm-hmm. so many terms. I would say for me, that's the biggest challenge for me personally, is just the communication of the science, whether it's mm-hmm. through presentations. Like, if you were to present to me on research you're doing, I can almost guarantee you more than half of what you're going to say is going to go over my head, just because, again, mm-hmm. there's so many what is that word, like, when people, what is that word now? See, I'm forget, like, it's a word that's used to like describe words that are only used in a specific industry.
Jargon.
Thank you. Yes. So like, there's mm-hmm. so much jargon in terms of biology mm-hmm. and people don't realize like how much of a knowledge curve or knowledge gap yeah. there is in mm-hmm. terms of like from when you start to what's like the standard. Mm-hmm. And so then like when people just talk normally about their research, it's like, wait, what is that? Wait, what is it? So just being patient in terms of
yeah,
consistently reading the research articles, asking, like you said, the right questions and trying to time them at the right time. Cause you know, you don't want to interrupt someone in the middle of a presentation.
Exactly.
But then it's also like, you might forget. So, okay, you learn to write things down and ask them afterwards, or mm-hmm. ask them during questions, or just one-on-one with them, or even mm-hmm. like, honestly, like, cause I've had so many questions. I feel like if I ask someone that many questions, okay, it's just going to be too much. Go on your own and start finding exactly. the answers to like the mm-hmm. terms that you're confused with. But it's really been the jargon for me that's just like, whoa, like this is gonna take some time. I think that's really for me the hardest part right now, just the jargon. Yeah.
But I would just say keep at it, because I think right now you're just in the process of gathering those words and trying to make sense of it. Eventually they'll all start making sense and you wouldn't have to go back. I think it's just a matter of time. Just mm-hmm. spend some more time and keep reading. I think yeah. another thing, you know, which really helped me when I started reading articles, mm-hmm. these research papers, was, you know, either you explain it to someone like you're explaining to 5-year-old. So mm-hmm. if you can explain the study mm-hmm. to someone like you're a 5-year, like the person is 5-year-old, then you have understood it well. Mm-hmm. And the second would be maybe just like after you've read the article, just write 5 points. Like in your words, summarizing the paper, that will really, you know, help you understand whether you have understood it. You mm-hmm. know, that could be really helpful just to summarize the entire paper. So next yeah. time, and just like put a sticky on it. So next time when you're just going through these, you want to refer back to a paper, you can just mm-hmm. read your summary and you can get an idea that, oh, this paper is basically talking about this. You
know? Absolutely. No, so, yeah.
So something that helped me over these years. Yes. Mm-hmm. So... And yeah, I remember this is a very important plug that I need to put in right here. That we discussed the previous time, that I want to say, and thank you so much that you really find my videos helpful.
I really do. Like, I'm not just like, oh, you know, I would love to talk to you just to talk. Like, I really, yeah. like, I was like, wow, you explain it so well. And mm-hmm. like, you're not afraid to like, all right, like, I'm sure, I mean, the videos you upload, they're like 40 minutes long, but I'm sure you spend way more than that just to like edit things out or, you know, prepare the videos. Like, yeah. so I really want to like commend you. Like, that's quite a lot of work. I'm, you know, you're working and like, just so mm-hmm. I appreciate what you're doing for the community. I really do. And like you said too, like, I do hope that one day, like, I can then also continue that as well with you. And like, we can like bring more awareness to like bioinformatics. Because you're right, like I've already been telling people, oh, I'm studying bioinformatics. I'm like, what is it? I don't understand. Like, what do you mean?
Exactly.
Is it biology? Is it informatics? What? Yeah.
Yeah. No, I really appreciate that. And I want more people to create content on bioinformatics because I think it requires more people to talk about more topics and more comprehensively and, you know, in general, increase the awareness. But here is an important plug. So, you know, this is something that I've always wanted to say, but I never got an opportunity to say in my videos or anywhere on my you know, channel. But I really want to say that I'm not an expert. I don't want people to follow me by the T. You know, I think I want to provide a starting point. I think that's my idea behind my channel, that I'm giving you a starting point. So I want people to then explore from there. I just don't want them to, you know, just, you know, follow me and just like,
yes, absolutely.
Consider what I'm trying to say as the absolute truth. I could be wrong, you know, I've realized this over some time that I have made like some mistakes in my previous videos, which is not like I would have done differently, I would say. But I guess my goal is just to, you know, provide an idea and a starting. I think that's a very important plug that I wanted to say.
Good. No, I'm glad. You're right. I totally forgot to mention, like...
No, that's totally fine.
It's so true. Like, people forget, like, when you're recording videos, that's just, like, a snapshot of what you know in that moment.
In that run.
Because you like, on another day, you might already know, like, oh, yeah, remember, don't make this mistake.
Yeah.
But then in the video, you might just make a mistake. Like, it just happens, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's just part of being a human being. Like, we're going to mess up.
Exactly. That's so well said.
On the flip side too, let's say we're experts, right? Like, experts still make mistakes, and even so, experts don't know your life, your journey, where you're coming from, and your own wants and needs, which is why I reiterate, when you have any goal or whatever in mind, ask yourself, like, sort of, what is the point? Like, where am I at? Where am I going? You know, and then you can sort of assess for yourself. And I find it funny you mentioned, like, with the research articles, go through and like make like 5 bullet points of like, what was the point? Like, what did you read? Because I sort of do that with your videos in terms of like, all right, I'll get through the end, because they are a bit long. So sometimes, you know, like I do breaks and like, okay. And then at the end of it, I'm like, all right, what can I say I took from this? Like, what did I synthesize and gather from this video, you know? And I'm like last week it was like just this one little function that you were using. I was like, okay, cool. And I learned a little more about that. And like, so just add to like I like to think of knowledge sort of like this brick wall, right? So like each day, just like make one brick, add it to your brick of knowledge, you know, and then from there, your brick wall is going to continue to grow and grow even more. But it just takes that first step of like...
First step.
Yeah, that, you know, so...
The starting point.
Exactly, the starting point. The starting point. So just, yeah, I mean, and I do that with books too, funny enough. Like I'll read a book and then at the end of the chapter, I like to like write like 1 to 5 like key ideas or takeaways from that chapter. And then I'll write it like, and then put it in there and then go to the next one. And then I also want to plug in too, because I know we're big fans of Notion. So if you want to go more digital, then you know, you can use Notion, create pages of like, okay, research articles, and then within that, the titles of your articles, and you can take notes in that. So you can carry that, whether it's on your phone or, you know, on your computer, whatever, you have it all on your devices. If you don't want
to, it's easy to share as well.
Exactly, which is why I'm a big fan of it too. And like, like as soon as I'm like, oh, I want to make a quick edit. Sometimes I can't do that with my books, right? But but if I keep them in here, like, in it's really helpful. So I'm a big fan of digitizing what you can, but you know, if you like old school, do old school, or maybe do both, you know. Like I've learned to sort of do both. Like I have my library, but I'm also embracing more ebooks just because they're easier to carry, they're cheaper, you know. It's like, so find what works for you though. Again, what is the point? What works for, like, where are you at? What are you trying to do? What works for you and in your life, in your own situation? Because everybody's different. So did that answer your question? I'm not sure.
Yes, it did. It did.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay.
Thank you.
Cool. Absolutely. Any other questions?
No, I guess we've rambled on enough.
That's fine. Hey, we can ramble. Okay. And like, Well, no, cool. I'm glad this is really, you know, really great discussion, and I hope it was of value to others.
I just want to add, so, you know, it would be interesting if mm-hmm. I would want to invite people to leave specific questions in the mm-hmm. comments. If there okay. are enough and interesting questions, we might mm-hmm. do a part two of this.
Yes, please, please ask questions, because I would love to do a part 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so just ask. You know, we could even make it a thing of like at some point, man, I mean, I don't know how when, but you know, at some mm-hmm. point we do like a little like either live stream or something where like we just answer people's questions. Like, oh, okay, you know,
yeah.
I don't know how far down the road that might be, but yeah, you know,
we don't know that.
I mean, but that would be fascinating. But we're stating it now. You know, I don't know if it's going to take 5 years or whatever. But we're stating it now. All right.
Just put it out on the universe.
Exactly. You really don't. But cool. I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for coming on. Just taking the time to talk, share your journey. Again, neither one of us are experts, and even if we were, just ask yourself, what is the point? You know, what is? Yeah. Take a look at your own life situation. Again, just self-awareness, really. But, you know, I look forward to continuing to serve you guys. It was really just a great discussion. And please let me know if you guys have any questions as well. Any last words, Coach Brew?
I would just want to say thank you so much. I really, really enjoyed talking to you. And I got to say all the things that I don't get to say in my videos. So I really enjoyed this conversation. I'm really hoping that you enjoy bioinformatics. You continue your journey in bioinformatics. I'm looking forward to reading interesting research from you in the coming years. And we'll definitely stay in touch and keep sharing the papers that we find interesting. Yes,
absolutely. And
looking forward to a part two, hopefully.
Absolutely. Thank you. And, you know, actually, something that just came up too. Another thing we could even try doing, like, in the future, and, you know, we'll mm-hmm. chat more, I'm sure. But, like, we could even look at, like, reviewing research articles together. That might be something
that could be cool, right?
Like,
because
I do feel like the communication aspect is something that's mm-hmm. really difficult, again, mm-hmm. at least for me coming from tech into bio. So then being able to like, hey, all right, we're going to jump on together and we're going to take our interpretations of what we got out of the articles. And like, you know, that might be something, you know, that might be, I don't know, you know, that might be something.
Yeah, that would be really interesting. Yeah.
Think about it, you know, like you know, just let
a
it,
lot
like,
of future aspects. To
exactly.
Consider,
yeah. So, but, well, I'm glad you enjoyed. And, yeah, I look forward to the next one.
Sounds good. Thank you so much, Ryan.
Thank you so much. Take care, everybody.